Welcome to The Standard. From Vancouver, I'm Peter Klein. Tonight, an exclusive interview with Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations, who speaks candidly about resisting U.S. influence in his country. But first, a remarkable discussion with a husband and wife who say his affair, surprisingly, saved their marriage. Anne Bercht says she was living her dream life. She had a successful, good-looking husband, wonderful kids, and a sense of security she thought was impenetrable. That was until her husband walked in one day and announced he was having an affair. The news sent shockwaves through every single facet of their life, a journey she's chronicled in her provocatively titled book, My Husband's Affair Became the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. Anne and her husband have been on Oprah, Dr. Phil, and travel North America trying to help other couples going through the rocky challenge of infidelity. Anne Bercht joins me now. Welcome, Anne.
Hi, Peter.
If you would, maybe tell us about that moment when you first heard your husband was having an affair. How did he tell you, and what was your reaction?
He said he had something to talk to me about, and so I was actually a little bit excited at first, thought maybe we're going to have this nice heart-to-heart chat, and made a couple of cups of coffee, and sat down. And no words. He didn't speak. I thought, well, he initiated this conversation. I kept waiting. Mm-hmm. No words. And the longer that silence got, the more the fear just started to creep all over me. What does my husband have to share with me that is so bad that he can't say it?
Did you anticipate this might be it, or do you think it was a medical issue? I mean, what was going through your mind during that silence?
I didn't have a finger on what it could have been. Like I said, when I first started, I thought it would have been a good thing. Mm-hmm. And ironically, that very night before he had initiated the conversation, I was coming back from, I'd been taking voice lessons, and I was singing in my car, and I had that Toni Braxton song on, Unbreak My Heart. And I'm singing alone in the car, and I'm thinking, boy, what a great song, but those words are depressing. But good thing that could never happen to me, because we have such a good marriage. And here, this is the very night that my husband's telling me that there's somebody else.
So when you found out, after he told you, was it sort of shock? Was it anger? Did you want revenge? How did you react?
Shock. Yeah. Absolute devastation. One person that I worked with described the feeling of when her husband told her as if he had taken a dagger and thrown it across the room and pinned her up like this with the knife in her heart and she's stuck to the wall. That's about what it feels like. And nothing ever prepares you for that moment. I asked a couple of basic questions. Did I know her? Was she married? And then I just basically sat there all night, never slept, didn't move from my chair, just in shock.
And did you go and call your friends, or were you embarrassed about this? Did you share this with your friends?
In the morning, after I took my kids to school, the first thing I did was shared it with my closest friend. And she was absolutely devastated as well. If you could imagine two women sitting 45 minutes without saying a word after I told her. And but in the beginning, while we healed, which took us 2.5 years, we shared with maybe about 10 people, just a small circle of people to support us through the devastation and the crisis. Other than that, we definitely kept it private and to ourselves.
Now, initially, your husband was going to move out, or he did move out?
Moved out for 2 weeks, and it was crazy. It was chaos. Our once role model family just comes apart.
And you had three kids, right?
Three kids.
I mean, when did you tell them?
He told them. And they were 12, 14, and 16. And the first daughter, he told me on a Monday night. By Friday, he had told the first daughter, and then the other, it was a week or so later. And basically, we had a conversation on that Friday night. You know, I said, well, you'll just have to never see her again. Another long silence. Mm-hmm. I began to realize he didn't even know who he wanted to spend the rest of his life with. This is after 18 years in a good marriage. You're supposed to be having arguments. You're supposed to be having problems. There's supposed to be something wrong. And so we were having an argument, her, me, make up your mind, and I was not being calm about it. And he shouted back at me, her then. Packed his duffel bag and left, and I heard, I'm leaving you and marrying her. But really what was going on was he couldn't stand the pressure I was putting on him. He couldn't stand the pressure the other woman was putting on him, and he just wanted to get away from both of us to get some space and think about what to do.
Now, you didn't know this other woman, did you?
No.
Did you meet her? You wanted to meet her?
I did. I did have an encounter with
That's
her.
That's sort of untraditional, right? I mean, oftentimes there's a sense that you don't even want to know anything about the other person. But you, why did you want to meet her?
Frankly, I wanted to meet her because it could not remain a mystery to me for the rest of my life who was this woman who, after 18 years, could steal the affections of my husband. Right. I wanted to see what she looked like. And contrary to what a lot of therapists might believe, see that it can actually work out to be a positive situation. For me, meeting the other woman was quite healing. But you have to go with the right motives, that somehow that you can play this out in your mind as something that's going to be positive, at least for yourself, to bring healing and closure. And if you're expecting, you know, the other woman to apologize, or if you just want to yell at her and tell her off and make a fool of yourself, which we usually do, well, in the long run, that's not going to make you feel better or solve anything.
So what was that moment like? I mean, how did she react meeting you?
For me, it was an extremely empowering moment. She was, I perceived her to be nervous, which is understandable, and I think surprised. It was just a very odd moment. She invited me in for coffee. Really, people almost have to read the story in the book as to what actually happens in that moment. But I have to be the only woman in the world who would show up at the home of the woman who's planning to marry my husband with a little bag of teaching supplies on my side for the visual demonstration that I'm going to do to her to show her how leaving her husband and marrying my husband is not about to give her the happiness in her life that she's longing for.
Wow.
And I think I left an impact.
Yeah, I bet you did. How have your other your children were at a pretty important age. I mean, old enough to really understand what's going on, but probably, certainly the younger two, not necessarily having the emotional maturity to really appreciate it. How did they react? Do they feel anger at him, at your husband?
No, I mean, the two younger ones, like you say, they also have softer personalities, so they were regret. It was really quite sad for my youngest daughter because when I was tucking her into bed one night after he had told her, she said, "I wish we lived in the Bible times." And I was thinking, Bible times? Why would she be saying that? So I said, "Why?" And she said, "Oh, because then Dad could just have two wives." And you just devastated because you're realizing the impact that these choices of adults are having on kids. But the oldest, who was 16, she had a very strong personality. She was not taking it lightly, and she was directing all of her anger in the same way that I was, which was towards the other woman. She actually called the other woman, which I'm sure was not a happy conversation, and the things that were said would not be appropriate for television.
Now, at what point did you realize he was not going to leave you?
That was really a long time. I mean, he came back, you know, as I said, after the 2 weeks away, but it was hardly the homecoming that you would expect. Yeah. Like, you would think, okay, he's had an affair. Obviously, he should be on his knees begging for forgiveness with flowers. That's not the way it was. You know, he asked to come home one night, and we talked for a while, and then I kind of went to bed, he went to bed, and we were both lying on the bed, fully closed, looking at the ceiling, and I said, "What are you doing here?" And he goes, "I guess I'm home." And I'm thinking, what did I do in letting him in? Do I even want this man? So there, it was a roller coaster, it was up and down. And for myself, I would go through different phases where there would be times when I would think, this isn't going to work. Even 6 months and a year later, I think, this isn't going to work. There's no way I can forgive him. And then I would curse myself for not being better prepared to be financially secure and for the kids, you know, if we got a divorce. And then I enrolled myself in university. I started, you know, using our time together to launch my own degree at the time. And then I'd re-fall in love with him. And I went through that cycle quite a number of times during the years towards healing.
So. We have to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll meet Anne's husband, Brian. He'll be here to share his side of his story.
Peter Klein's wardrobe for The Standard is provided by Sam Tanney and Son Tailors in Langley. Men's and women's tailoring. Sam Tanney and Son. Fitted for you. Fitted right.
I'm back with Anne Bercht, the author of My Husband's Affair Became the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. Joining us is Anne's husband also, Brian Bercht. Welcome.
Hi.
So Brian, we just heard Anne's story. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about the story from your perspective. If you wouldn't mind, how did this affair start?
Well, it was something I really hadn't thought about and hadn't really planned, but it kind of just evolved out of a relationship I developed with a person at work, and it, you know, one thing sort of leads to another. The friendship developed into a, you know, more from an acquaintanceship into a friendship, which became a little bit more emotionally involved. And
so it was really more of an emotional affair initially, or relationship.
Absolutely.
Nothing physical.
Yeah, nothing. First. Yeah, that's right. It, you know, it was just the level of connection that we had just sort of was something a little more powerful than I actually even imagined. And so one thing led to another where we developed this close friendship, and then we ended up developing, you know, let's go for lunch. And, you know, so even though it was against what I thought I, you know, what Anne and I had established in our relationship, you know, I began to justify why it was okay, and, you know, all the little things I was telling myself.
So you were rationalizing along
the
way.
Yeah, you know, because I had to live with myself.
Well, what were the rationalizations?
Well, I mean, just little things like, well, we hadn't done anything that was really wrong. We hadn't touched each other. We hadn't kissed. We hadn't had sex. We didn't, you know, I was, you know, was just a friend. And, you know, there was, this, you know, we hadn't really done anything that was inappropriate. Mm-hmm. And apart from the fact that I went for lunch and never told Anne about that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there was not, there really didn't seem like any of the signs of what an affair was about, because I, you know, understood that affairs at that point in my life, anyway, I thought mostly affairs were about people that had a, you know, bad relationship, or they was not getting any sex at home, or
right. That's the perception is that, you know, a man has an affair when something's really bad at home.
Sure.
I mean, there's a sort of a coldness between the husband and wife. There's no sex. All those things.
Yeah.
What was it like in your home? I mean, from your perspective, it sounded like the relationship was great. You had no indication. I mean, what about from your perspective?
Yeah,
did you consider your relationship with Anne a healthy relationship, despite the fact that you were estranged?
Oh, absolutely. I was actually even telling the other person about, you know, how good a relationship she could have had. Because, you know, I was looking at what Anne and I did and our relationship was quite strong. And we actually, you know, I was one of those few guys that would read actually a relationship book that I, you know, of course, I probably didn't buy any of them, but I did read them and I actually practiced some of the things that were said in there. And so our relationship was quite strong. And, you know, we weren't fighting. We were getting along. We actually, you know, our sex
life.
You had
intimacy.
Yeah, our sex life was great. And so all the telltale signs of what I perceived an affair was about, those were not anything that were happening in my life. And so then I, you know, so my thought is with the other person, developing this this friendship is really all what I thought it was, seemed just sort of appropriate. And, you know, and as that relationship kind of deepened and, you know, I got closer to the boundary of what was right and wrong, you know, that's when the affair really kind of was sort of taken over, and, you know, all the rationalization justifications that go on in my mind
just went out the window.
Well, they all still made sense because I, you know, they're all incremental. Mm-hmm. And so I went from doing one thing and I moved it.
Well, slowly. How do you rationalize sleeping with someone else?
At that point, when you're actually physically involved, sleep, then you're already over the line.
Right.
And then it was, you know, like in our work, what we do now, I tell people it's about, you know, we push this boundary. When we get to this boundary. What we don't do is the boundary isn't permanent. It moves, and we just push the boundary so far. But then when we're sleeping with them or having, you know, some level of intimacy on, you know, on a physical level, we already know that we've already we're on the other side of that. And then, you know, what I say is we play this thing called the hoping game. You know, it's like we hope something that we'll wake up from our dream, right, or that, you know, we hope the other person gets hit by a bus or something, one of those things, you know. But
well, Anne told us about when you yeah, revealed to her about the affair, and then you moved out. You even at one point sort of blurted out, okay, I'll choose her over you. Mm-hmm. What was going through your mind? Did you ever really seriously consider that?
Right at that time, I mean, I might have thought about it a little bit. I mean, I was just kind of looking for some space to escape, and there was certainly pressure from Anne. There was certainly a lot of pressure from the other woman to kind of, you know, to move our relationship to that sort of next level. Right.
The reason you revealed this whole thing was partly because of pressure from her that you were afraid she might reveal it to your wife.
Yeah,
right?
There was probably a little bit of a cowardly act, but then also I felt that at some level that I did have some responsibility. Mm-hmm. I mean, to tell Anne, I did thought if she found out that through somebody else, it would be kind of, that would probably be the hardest thing. So I figure at some level I could tell her and see how she reacted, and, you know, of course didn't think we'd ever survive.
Right. Well, Anne, let me ask you, the common wisdom that I better tell her so she doesn't find out from someone else. Is it better that he told you, or?
Absolutely.
It
would make it a lot easier for me to heal hearing it from him, as opposed to if you hear it from somebody else. Like, that's just so demoralizing, mm-hmm, and so degrading, and it's harder to rebuild right, trust. So, yeah, definitely better to hear it from him.
I mean, looking back on this, other than the fact of having an affair, just in terms of how he handled it, would you say that, being honest with you, getting a little space to sort of figure out what's going on, was that the right way to handle it?
There was some good things in what we did, but there were certainly a lot of wrong things, which is why we do the work that we do, because as we reached out to the professionals for help, we found, some things were helpful, but some things we feel were almost damaging to the relationship.
What professionals were telling you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and not understanding the deep level of trauma that I was really feeling at that point, the fact that I couldn't think straight. So it was good that he told me. Maybe space was good, but the way it was done, yelling her then, the things that were said, yeah, there was a lot of chaos that wasn't healthy for sure.
Well, I want to talk about the work that you guys are doing, and also about how faith really helped you guys get through this. We have to take a short break, but we'll be back for a few more minutes with Anne and Brian Brecht after this quick break. I'm back with Anne and Brian Bercht. Anne is the author of My Husband's Affair Became the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. You guys travel North America now, talking very candidly about your affair and how to help people. Before the break, you were saying that what the professionals, what the therapists, what marriage counselors told you sometimes was helpful, sometimes wasn't helpful. What was helpful that they told you that you've passed on?
One of the things that was helpful was telling me not to make any major decisions about the relationship for at least 3 months from finding out. Mm. So, not taking off and ending it all, that was helpful, for sure. Yeah.
And what kinds of things did they tell you that you look back on and realize, I don't think I want to pass on that advice?
Things about, instead of looking at the affair itself, to say, let's not talk about the affair. Let's talk about what was wrong in your marriage to cause the affair. And there's an assumption there that leads many people away from finding the truth out about the affairs. And while I don't deny that there's many marriages that have a lot of problems in them today, and certainly those marriages would be more vulnerable to affairs,
sure,
what they're missing is those are not the only reasons. There can be personal vulnerabilities. Like, why not look at the person who had the affair as being responsible instead of sort of putting it over on the...
Do you feel any blame at all for this? I mean, when you look back on this, Anything you...
All the time. Here I was absolutely devastated, and that's what the professionals would often say. Well, Anne, I wonder what you did to cause your husband to have an affair. And even my medical doctor, I had, you know, lost this drastic amount of weight. My health was suffering.
And you stopped eating for, like... 45 days or something.
I mean, 25 days, and couldn't sleep for 3 nights. And so there was this radical weight loss, and you're going through this major trauma, which is a huge stress. So it was affecting my health. I went to see my medical doctor, and I had that little 15-minute appointment. And he got his prescription pad out, and he wrote the title of a book, 101 Nights of Great Sex, and he handed it to me. This is a professional, and he said, here, read this. It will solve all your problems. And it totally didn't apply in our situation. Not to mention that, you know, a lot of our esteem as individuals is tied into our sexual identity. Right. And here's another man basically insinuating, gee, you must have been really bad in bed. Like, it was an insult. Yeah. It added harm.
So you must be approached by men who are in a similar situation that you were in. Do they seek you out? Do people seek you out who are in the middle of an affair saying, what should I do?
Sometimes we do that. Sometimes they're steered toward me through their wife or if it's the woman who's had the affair as well, they're steered by their husband. But generally, you know, I'm sought out and asked, well, how did you get, you know, did you make it? How long does it last? What can I do? And usually what I suggest to them is, you know, the first thing they need to do is quit blaming their spouse for what they've done. Mm-hmm. And certainly in the work that we do, you know, we make it very clear that the person who had the affair is totally 100% responsible for that. And no matter how bad their marriage was or how, you know, messed up things were at home or whatever was getting or not getting, there's other ways to change a marriage without having to go having an affair. So, but a lot of the people do seek me out and just wondering what they need to do. And I really try to help them and steer them in the direction of what they really need to be looking at within themselves and not looking at all the external things as to, well, my wife didn't do this or, you know, or my relationship was, you know, all these things were missing in it. Because ultimately the person who had the affair made those decisions and they made the choices they did, not necessarily all premeditated, but still the decisions to pick up the phone, to call that person, to send a text message, to you know, to meet them for dinner, to go to the hotel room, those were all choices that they actively participated in. And so it's really up to that individual to find the strength within themselves to be able to do the right thing for their spouse, not just for their spouse, but mostly for themselves. Mm-hmm. Because ultimately, if you can't solve it the first time, you know, then that saying is true, that if you're once a cheater, you're always a cheater. And the only time that you can really resolve that is if you can figure out why you did it the first time, take the right preventative measures so it'll never have to happen again.
Right. So, well, you know, celebrity lives are almost extreme versions of our lives in many ways. And I think a lot of people are captivated by those celebrity stories because they're analogous to our lives, often blown up, and Tiger Woods is perhaps the best example in terms of infidelity. His infidelity, you know, yours obviously pales by comparison. He did who knows how many times. Yeah. What would your advice be to him, to his family? I mean, what has he handled this situation appropriately in your opinion?
A lot of it's been behind the scenes, so you know, you gotta wonder, you know, what has been happening. And I feel bad for them because I think something that would multiply it, make it more difficult, is the fact that they, you know, I mean, I can't even imagine what it would be feel like to have been in that devastating moment and to be chased by paparazzi in my worst possible moment. But definitely delaying the decision of what to do one way or another, seeking help, taking responsibility. And one of the biggest mistakes those who've had affairs tend to make, which we would recommend they don't make, is they do things like minimizing the amount of the affairs. Of course, I think.
And that's what he did, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then what happens is it gets worse. How can I trust you when you were lying, when you claimed to be telling the truth in Tiger's case, and you lied to the whole world, you know? And So, and then of course, on the flip side, the one who's been betrayed often makes drastic decisions and does things that can't be taken back in their anger. So being able to suspend those responses and think them through. I always say to betrayed spouses, you know, just because your spouse made a choice to have an affair and maybe in some ways lowered their dignity and character by doing so, how does you lowering your dignity as a response make things better?
Right. I think one of the things in their situation, and this is what I would probably say to most people, is healing from an affair, is it takes two people to do the work, and it's not just the responsibility of one person. Certainly the person who's unfaithful needs to do their part and you know, be 100% responsible. But the work of healing is a choice that both get to make, and not only did Anne grant me that gift of willing to participate in it, but she actually did, you know, she actually had to do some work herself. And one of the things we found in just kind of the work we do now is really to educate people on how to do that together and how to be able to minimize the damage and capitalize on the good things within a relationship. How do you shift to make your relationship better? Because ultimately Anne's book, you know, My Affair, it became the best thing that happened to us because of the personal growth we both learned and that we developed today, you know, today as a couple. We have a better relationship now than ever before, though it was good before the affair. But I always say to people, you know what, I wouldn't go back and undo all the pain I caused only to live back in that relationship that I had because of where we're at today. And
we just have a couple seconds left, yeah. But I do want to ask you about faith. And, you know, obviously religion isn't part of everyone's life, but it has been part of your life. Has it helped you get through this?
When the person that I loved and trusted the most in the world had betrayed me in the worst possible way, it was an amazing anchor to know that God still loved me, that God was still there with me.
And that's helped you get through this?
Yeah, absolutely, yes. Yeah. I think it would help me to really understand there was forgiveness and grace that when in fact I wouldn't have believe possible, sort of certainly at that time, you know, when I revealed to Anne or even within the months subsequent to that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
Great. Thank
you
for having
book.
Us. Thank you.
Thank you.
The name of the book again is My Husband's Affair Became the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. The Bercht's website is beyondaffairs.com. Coming up next, an exclusive interview with Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Our next interview is an exclusive with Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations. The interviewer is senior producer of this show, Jonathan Roth.
Seven years ago, the United States was in the middle of its invasion of Iraq. Much water has passed under the bridge since then, but what is clear is that Iraq is now functioning somewhat on its own, with U.S. combat forces scheduled to leave the country next year. His Excellency Hamid Al Bayati is Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations, and Ambassador Bayati is joining me from Columbia University in New York. Welcome to The Standard, Ambassador.
Thank you.
Now, you recently had parliamentary elections in the country, and what seems clear is that voting was seemingly along ethnic lines. How does a country like Iraq move away from these divisions of the past and look towards the future, and yet at the same time you're grappling with a situation where when you do have you know, voting in the country, people tend to vote along their own ethnic and sectarian lines?
Well, we are in a transitional period. People suffered from Saddam regime because Saddam oppressed certain ethnic, sectarian, religious groups. When Saddam fought the Kurds, he played on the ethnic card. When he fought the Shiite, he played on the sectarian card. And when he fought the Christian, he was a Muslim hero against the crusade. He followed a policy of divide and rule. Therefore, there are worries and concerns and fears among different communities. This is why that make them stick to the parties and groups which defend their rights, the right of the ethnic or sectarian or religious group. However, we've seen some progress since 2005. In this recent election on March 7th, people start to vote on the basis of national loyalty, loyalty to Iraq rather than to the group or to the sect.
Right. Now, a question for you, because I think a lot of, at least Westerners, view this whole problem and see it as something that obviously Saddam Hussein had a large role in propagating in the divisions between the Shias and the Sunnis. But realistically, this is a division that's been going on for hundreds of years. Is it really possible to heal that rift between the Sunnis and the Shiites?
If we talk about Iraq as a nation, the people didn't have any problem for centuries. They lived together in peace and harmony. However, they suffered from oppression of dictatorship or brutal regimes such as Saddam. So when Saddam oppressed the Kurds are afraid of the government. This is why they stick together. It's the same with any other sectarian or religious groups. Even with the Christians, they were oppressed. Their churches were demolished. Priests, they were arrested and executed. Now, it will take some time when Iraqis go back and start to be loyal to the country rather than to the sect or to the ethnic group. So, and Al-Qaeda play an important role in dividing the people. Al-Qaeda tried to bring a sectarian wrong between the Sunnis and Shiites because they thought they will have the support of the Muslim world, which is Sunni, the majority are Sunnis. And Al-Zarqawi wrote to Osama bin Laden that if the Iraqi government gets stronger and control the situation, they will have no option but to pack and leave as they did in Afghanistan. And the only solution, as he put it, the leader of Al-Qaeda in Iraq, to Osama bin Laden, to bring sectarian war between the Sunnis and the Shiites.
Okay, let me move from there and talk a little bit about the American occupation. At this, where we stand currently today, is the American withdrawal next year still on course?
Yes, I think according to the status of forces agreement, all U.S. forces should be withdrawn by end of 2011. That is going to happen.
Now, with that coming up here next year, I'm not sure. That's why I'm going to ask you. Has there been some concern within the Iraqi government that the Obama administration is not nearly as focused on Iraq as it should be, vis-a-vis taking a look at what they've been doing in Afghanistan? Afghanistan certainly seems to be the war that President Obama was talking and discussing during the election campaign over a year ago, and even in terms of what he's done within the last few months in Afghanistan. What is your perspective on how the Obama administration has handled your country?
Of course, Obama administration has different priorities, and Afghanistan is their priority. However, we believe that there's a success story in Iraq. We get rid of Saddam dictatorship. We have democracy in Iraq, which is helping the Iraqi people, the region, and the whole world. And we believe that U.S. administration should build on the success in Iraq to have success somewhere else, like democracy in Afghanistan. It wouldn't be a success without learning from the lessons in Iraq.
Well, listen, we're just going to take a quick break, but when we come back, I want to talk about Iran's nuclear program and where Iraq stands on that issue. More with Ambassador Al Bayati after this quick break.
Welcome back for part two of our exclusive interview with Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations. Jonathan Roth, the senior producer of this program, is the interviewer.
I'm back with His Excellency Hamid Al Bayati, Iraq's ambassador to the United Nations. He's joining me from Columbia University in New York. Ambassador, just before the break, I brought up the fact that Iran's ongoing nuclear program is certainly a concern here in the West. Where does Iraq stand on that issue?
Iraq is part of the Arab League, and the Arab League adopted a policy of Middle East free zone of all kind of WMD, especially nuclear weapons. Therefore, we believe that the whole Middle East should be free of all kind of nuclear weapons.
So, from your perspective, you do not, if Iran is certainly developing a nuclear weapons program, you are not on side with that?
Yes, of course. We are against nuclear weapons owned by any country in the region. And we think that any weapons will affect Iraq as a country, an important country, especially Iran. We have long borders with Iran, and that would be devastating for Iraq.
Now, we all know that Iran seems to be continuing its program no matter what the West seems to be doing. If the United States would ever request flyover rights over Iraq to invade Iran or bomb Iran, would Iraq allow that?
No, definitely not. We announced, the government announced that they would not allow any foreign forces to use Iraq as a, or the airspace as a land or an airspace to attack any other country in the region. Iran is saying that they have a nuclear program for peaceful means, which is the right of any country who is a member in the NPT. And for us, we think that this file should be solved through peaceful means rather than war or attack.
So do you support the current sanctions regime that the United States seems to be pushing?
Well, we are part of the UN, and we suffered from sanctions in Iraq, and we believe sanctions will not affect anything. We believe in peaceful means to solve the problem, and I think there were negotiation in the past between, you know, the European and the P5 plus Germany with Iran. That would be a good way forward.
But let's get down to brass tacks here, because this dispute has been ongoing now, you know, dating back to the Clinton administration. There seems to be no question that Iran is continuing its program no matter what the West says. So sooner or later, we all know this is going to come to a head. If sanctions don't work, if a peaceful discussion between the West and Iran simply can't work, what should be done in your estimation?
Well, if you're talking about negotiations since Clinton time, Iran several times agreed to freeze all kind of enrichment, but the whole world turned a blind eye and they left the situation. They didn't continue or pursue the negotiation. So it's not one side. I think the West is looking from their angle, and you have, in politics, you have to look from different angles. You have to have the whole picture. And we don't think that a military solution will be good for Iraq, for the region, or for the world.
All right, I just want to turn back the clock here quickly and talk a little bit about the actual invasion and occupation of Iraq. Because it seems like, you know, you search the internet and you try to get a figure in terms of how many civilians have actually been killed in Iraq due to the war, and the numbers range anywhere from 70,000 to 1.2 million. What is the official number from the government of Iraq? And whatever that number happens to be, is the human toll, has it been worth it in your estimation?
Well, Saddam caused the death of millions of people. We had two wars against neighboring countries in 10 years' time. Saddam used chemical weapons against the Iraqi people in the north, in the center, and the south. And then he continued to challenge the whole world, the United Nations, and to threaten many countries in the region. So if Saddam continued in power, we could have more wars. And after the invasion and the liberation of Kuwait, he mobilized his troops against the Kuwaiti borders again in 1994. He tried to assassinate George Bush. George H.W. Bush in Kuwait in 1994. And then he supported Al-Qaeda. Abu Mus'ab al-Zarqawi, the leader of Al-Qaeda, was in Iraq. And he conducted an assassination against a U.S. high-ranking diplomat in Jordan called Lawrence Foley. Therefore, if Saddam continued to rule Iraq, we will see much more casualties in Iraq and in the region.
Okay, now I have two quick questions for you. Oil has always been seen as the primary motivator in terms of why the United States invaded Iraq. Since the Iraqi government has taken power in Baghdad, you folks have been handing out contracts to oil companies, and seemingly not always to oil companies that you would say are Western. You know, contracts have been handed out to Indian oil companies, to Chinese oil companies. Have you ever personally experienced any bitterness in terms of the way that has gone from the Americans?
I don't think the oil was a motive behind the war. Otherwise, Saddam could sell oil to the United States and to the West in much cheaper prices than anybody else. Saddam wanted to stay with any price. He was ready to give the oil of Iraq, the whole of Iraq, with cheaper prices. And if America wanted to buy the oil of Iraq, they could buy it with the money they spent on the war for many, many years. So I don't think the oil was the motive, but was Saddam rogue regime and who challenged all the international community, the United Nations resolutions, and threatening peace and security in the region and the world. Therefore, the oil being in Iraq being distributed to many countries, including the U.S., 15 contracts were signed in December, and including some U.S. companies, but companies from different parts of the world, East and West, had awarded these contracts according to the best bid they give to the Iraqi government in a transparent way in front of the media, in front of the officials, in front of the judicial officials. That was the best decision Iraq can take about oil and its future.
Okay, lastly, one quick question for you. What do you expect to happen here in Iraq over the next year?
Well, we expect to have a national unity government, a strong government, which live in peace with its people and its neighbors, and rebuild Iraq. We need to rebuild Iraq. We need services. The whole infrastructure was destructed during Saddam regime because of the wars and Saddam's policies. So hopefully the new government will be strong enough to provide services to Iraqi people. Hmm.
Thank you, Ambassador Al Bayati. My best to you.
Most welcome.
Thank you. More of The Standard in just a moment.
Welcome back. Last week, we aired the first ever television interview with Nate Phelps, the son of the American gay-hating preacher, Reverend Fred Phelps. The interview received coverage throughout North America and elicited a fair bit of feedback. Here's one email we received. Having just watched the program, I can fully understand why Nate Phelps has become disenchanted with what, in my opinion, is a gross misrepresentation of Christianity. It is unfortunate that teachings by churches like Westboro Baptist Church is what captures the attention of secular society, which in turn then makes it more difficult for others to gain acceptance in their attempt to spread the real truth of the Gospels and the message of grace that they contain. My heart does go out to Nate, and I will throw up a prayer for him. That's from Greg. If you have a question or comment, here's how you can get in touch with us. That's all the time we have for tonight's show. For everyone at The Standard, I'm Peter Klein. Thanks for watching.